Good evening.
Welcome to the June 13th Cape Elizabeth School Board meeting. At this point, I'd like to have us all stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd just like to let everyone know that Alan Hawkins, our superintendent, started out the day as our feeling quite well, but late in the afternoon, he took sick, and he is home recuperating, and I think we all agree that we hope he feels better and returns soon, because I could have used him tonight. But that being said, we did do some checking, and to hold a business meeting of the school board, according to state law, we do have to have a superintendent designee, and Alan has asked Mary to be our designee. So if I could have a motion to accept Mary Bruns as our designee today. Kevin, thank you.
I move that we accept Mary Bruns as superintendent designee for the purpose of this business meeting.
All right. Thank you so much. Is there a second?
Second.
You, Trish? Any discussion? All those in favor? We have 7-0. Adjustments to the agenda. We do need to remove under new business 11 a item number I, as we're not ready for the consideration of the negotiated agreement with the Cape Elizabeth Education Association. I would also like to add as item 11M, consideration for a school board resolution on the Tabor initiative as provided by Rebecca to all of us via email today. And then also as item number 11N would be an appointment or recommendation for the two school board members to serve on the turf field committee as established by the town council at yesterday's meeting. And Kevin?
I just received some information yesterday, so I would like to seek the board's permission for the extracurricular activities committee to seek further information on Sports Done Right and a formal affiliation with the Sports Done Right organization.
So you want to add that under new business for consideration?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anything else? All right. At this point, we have the approval of the April school board minutes that were included in your pack. And anybody have any comments or corrections?
Make a motion that we approve the school board minutes for May 9th, 2006.
Is there a second? Thank you, Trish. Any further discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. I think this evening I don't see our school representatives. I think they were quite anxious to start vacation early, but I would like to take the opportunity to thank Jack Fisher and Will Daly, who are our middle school representatives for the whole school year, and Connor Hankinson and Daly Gruen, who are our high school representatives, and also to wish Connor Hankinson good luck as he did graduate on Sunday, and he will be moving on. So we may see the others at some point, but good luck to Connor. And thank you. I also at this time would like to take comments from the public on non-agenda items for this evening. If there are any, they may come to the podium. Seeing none, we'll move on to communications. This is something that Alan usually does, and yeah, I'm going to try to attempt to fill in the gaps here along with Mary, but he has down here the closing and opening of school. I think, as most kids know at this point, June 16th, which is Friday, is the last official day of school. Pond Cove will be dismissed at 10:45, and the middle school will be dismissed at 11:20. As far as the opening of school...
Heads are shaking.
That's 10:20.
No.
10:25.
10:20, all right.
Middle school.
That makes more sense. I thought I got it off the internet, so you might check if I got it, if it's on there wrong. But it didn't make sense to me the way our usual bus schedule rolls, but then again, I'm constantly surprised. Pond Cove will be returning to school on 8/31, August 31st, as is the middle school. And at the high school, the freshmen will be returning on the 30th of August, and 10th, 11th, and 12th graders will be returning on the 31st. There's also item number 6B, which was under communications for the NIASC report. I wanted to make sure that all members of the school board had received the official copy of the NIASC report. It did not make the packet, but it will come in your mailboxes because it has a little bit more explanation that I think the school board members should be aware of. And some information regarding CEF grants. I just wanted to let the school board know that the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation recently awarded 9 grants to our 3 schools totaling $30,758. A little bit about some of the grants, I won't go into a lot of detail, but I will just give the names of them. At the high school, there is a grant called Starlight, Star Bright, which is a grant that's going towards the high school science department and is specifically working with some astronomy students and club members along with some physics capabilities. And it involves a very high-powered camera that will be used in conjunction with, I believe it's the USM, I guess, astronomy program. But that was approved. There will be a school garden for the Cape Elizabeth Middle School that will be in that center courtyard, and it will be designed and laid out by a variety of students and then maintained by our special ed students. We had also a grant for the Escapade Mentoring Program, which I think a lot of us are familiar with. It's an ongoing program for our special ed students. There was also a grant approved for the National History Day group that went down, or I think they are still in Washington, DC at this time. University of Maryland, I'm sorry. So there was a grant that was in support of them. There is also another high school grant called Project Zero Classroom 2006, and they will be sending one or two Achievement Center members or instructors to a conference. World Music Drumming Curriculum, this is for the middle school. Cape Robotics, this would be extending the Cape Robotics program that was so successful that they funded last year at the high school. And that will be extended down into the middle school where there is extensive interest. There is also a grant for the middle school, which is a large art display cases that will be lining the hallways that go down towards the front office to display some of the great artwork that the middle school students are, especially the 3D artwork that they work on. And lastly, there was a grant approved for the climbing wall. And this will be a partial funding for them to start to build a climbing wall at the middle school, which will again work in conjunction with both our high school program and our elementary school program. Lastly, I just wanted to also let the board know that CEF has recently approved and supported 2 teacher awards that will be given each year in recognition of the successful implementation of a grant and also in recognition of a staff member, either a teacher or staff, that has positively impacted students outside of academics. And this one would be called the Thompson Award. So you will hear more about that, but they are winding up a lot of their fundraising. And I just thought the grants were just a great, great addition to the end of the year and something to look forward to. Recognition. Students recognized by the Cape Elizabeth Arts Commission. Inside. Just want to make sure. Yes. Hi, Barry Rose, thanks. The Cape Elizabeth Arts Commission recently named 4 high school students the recipients of a gift
for recognition of their fine work, artwork, and their art will be framed and kept on display in the Cape Elizabeth Permanent Arts Collection. Congratulations to Ms. Emily Yang, Mrs. Shell Gregory, Ms. Whitney Legg, and I'm sorry, those were the three, there were not four. So again, congratulations, and we all look forward to seeing their art displayed in a lot of our public buildings in the town. At this time, we also wanted to take a moment to thank our bus drivers. Most recently, the bus drivers were honored through some of the parent organization appreciation breakfasts, along with the teachers. And I know that we had a special recognition of teachers, I think the last time we met during Teacher Appreciation Week. Our bus drivers are people that we literally entrust with the lives of our children, and very often we ask them to do a lot more than just be professional drivers. They are guidance counselors and mentors, and they, as I think we all know, they perform a lot of other things besides just getting our kids safely to school. So at this point, I'd like to have the school board thank them and hope that our parents and students will thank them at the end of the school year as they do their teachers and other staff at our school. Thanks. Employees. Yes, if you could do that, Mary, that would be helpful. We have employees and the number of years of service.
This is an annual recognition, and the teachers who are on this list, not just teachers, they're all employees, whether they're support staff, teachers, or administrators. All of these people will be officially recognized at a gathering of all the staff the first day of school when all the employees are together. But the school board has traditionally announced the people on the list at the June school board meeting. So I will read down through the list as quickly as I can. For 5 years, and it's people who have served a multiple of 5 years. For 5 years of service, Suki Bryden, food services, Sally Connolly, middle school teacher, Holly Forsyth, Pond Cove teacher, Brian Ficero, middle school teacher, Allison Hawks, middle school teacher, Bill Cook, social worker for special ed, Lisa Leonard, a middle school teacher, Gretchen McNulty, a high school teacher, Jeff Shedd, high school principal, Sarah Simmons, facilitator of curriculum and staff development, Mark Tinkham, the high school assistant principal, whom we're afraid we're losing, but he has been here for 5 years, Susan Pillsbury, who's an Ed Tech 2 in special ed, Ann Underdown, who is an Ed Tech 3 in special ed, Fran Vita Taylor, who's a teacher at Pond Cove, and Liz Wood, who is a custodian. For 10 years of service, we have Sandra Brown from Food Services and Connie Dean from Food Services, Mark Doughty, a custodian, Antoinette Harriman, another person from Food Services, Hannah Jones, a high school teacher, Claire LaBrie, who again is another one we have to say goodbye to, but this is her 10th year she's completing, Nancy Murphy, who's a high school teacher, Doug Worthley, who is a high school teacher. For 15 years of service, the list gets shorter as we go down here. For 15 years of service, Bill Brewington, who's a high school teacher, Susan Dana, who's a middle school teacher, Linda Paul, Pond Cove teacher, and Ann Valenti, Pond Cove teacher. For 20 years of service, Karen Allen, who's at Community Services, Barbara Cummings, who works in the high school health office, and Ingrid Stressinger, who's a Pond Cove teacher. We have no one this year with 25 years of service. We have lots of people with more than 25, but no one with exactly 25. For 30 years of service, we have Dick Mullen, who's a high school teacher. And for 35 years of service, we have Buddy Earle, who is a middle school teacher. And we want to applaud all of them for all of their service to the students and staff of Cape Elizabeth.
Great. Moving to the retirees that we'd like to honor this evening. Mary?
Yes, okay. We have four retirees whom we'd like to honor this evening. We are sad to see all of them go. They have been wonderful employees. Together they represent a huge number of years. Since I didn't know I was going to be talking about them tonight, I didn't add that up, but I know each one of them personally. I've known them ever since they came here to work, and I'm sorry to see them all go because I consider them personal friends. But I do wish them all the happiness they could possibly have in the next phase of their life, and I hope they have a wonderful time. To say something about the teacher retirees, we're going to ask the principals to step forward, and then after they say a few words, we will present the retirees with a small gift of the school board's appreciation. So we'll start with those from Pond Cove School. We have one teacher retiring from Pond Cove School, and she happens to be a special ed teacher, so we're asking Claire LaBrie, who's the special ed director, and Tom Eismeyer, who's the Pond Cove principal, to say a little bit about Janet Favor, who has been here how long, Janet?
17 years.
17 years.
Janet, I am not nearly as creative as you are. Janet last night showed us what a wonderful, wonderful writer she is. And the one thing that I can say about Janet is that whenever I had a student that went to her room for language arts, I always knew when they left her room that they would have made a lot of gains. She has been a wonderful special ed teacher. She has made our team look at some of our ideas, and she's helped to push the bar. And I will miss her as a colleague, I'll miss her as a friend, and I wish you the best of luck, and have fun writing. That's your next career.
We gave Janet a little send-off at a faculty meeting last week, and I must say I have almost nothing to say after Ogden's incredible send-off, even put the Horton ears on. But since you weren't there and weren't, actually you weren't treated to that poem from Ogden, I'll give you some idea of what Pond Cove is losing with Janet Favor. First, professionally, she's been an unbelievable member of the pupil services team. We always say we like to put kids first, and Janet has really done that. And I know that because she was constantly meeting with teaching teams and individual teachers and connecting her room with the classroom experience as much as she could, and I really admire her for that. It also leads to, I mean, her kids first leads her to, as she said last week, something that she won't miss from special ed, the paperwork. Second, on a more personal basis, Janet, as Ogden told us so well, has many, many talents that she brought not just to the kids, but we know more about her now. She's been here so long. She's well-traveled, she's well-read, she's energetic, she gets outdoors, she's a great gardener. And as I said, that helped bring her classroom alive. Through all this, she's led a very balanced life, personally and professionally, but she's earned the right now to tip the balance toward gardening and just enjoying herself. So congratulations. We'll miss you, but you get a well-deserved second life post-Pond Cove. Congratulations.
Janet, if you'd just come up, I would like to present this to you on behalf of the school board for your 17 years of service.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I don't know if I'm supposed to give a little speech or not.
Yes, we'd love to have you say a few words if you'd like.
I shouldn't have offered. No, I really am. I was thinking as I was coming over here, I remember very distinctly my applying for this job. I'd been called by Wayne Dorr in Africa. I was teaching in Africa. And he called me there and said, would you be interested in a job at Cape Elizabeth? It's only going to last 1 year because the teacher's going to have a baby. But, you know, at least you have a job when you get home. So I remember interviewing and really thinking that it would only be for 1 year, and I've been here 17, so I guess it's worked. But I've worked in a lot of different school systems, and the staff that I've worked with here have been the best of anywhere. I feel very, very fortunate that I have spent my time here. I feel like I've influenced a few lives, and they've certainly influenced me, and worked with some hard kids, but they've taught me a lot, and I've seen them graduate and get very, very teary when I see that happen, and know that they've accomplished a lot through special ed and the support that we've given them. So thank you very much for all your support, and I am going to have no more paperwork after Friday.
I just want you to know I was at that send-off, or the association dinner that Tom referred to, and we should have had Ogden come read that poem. It would have taken a long time, but it was worth it. Okay, now we move on to the middle school. We have two teachers from the middle school, Carolyn Russ, who has served in several different roles during her time here that Steve will speak to, and Mary Murphy, who wasn't able to come tonight. But we appreciate both of them, and Steve, you have a few words about each of them.
Good evening, folks. Madam Superintendent, how's that? I'm going to start off by speaking about Mary Murphy, even though she would say, Mary's made it very clear from the day she mentioned that she was going to retire. It was kind of like she drew a little space on my desk and said, all I want to do is just set up my keys here, and I just want to kind of drift off. I don't want anything said. I don't want anything. Let's just do this quietly. This is going to be a tough thing. So I promised her I wouldn't speak about her, so here I go. Anyways, I was looking through her file, and Mary and I were getting a kick out of the fact that her first round of evaluations back in 1970 were mimeocopies and everything, and half of it was handwritten, and I could smell the fluid, you know, it just brought me back. And Sturridge Hodgson was the principal at the time, and Harold Reynolds was the superintendent. So that was, it's been quite a while. She is currently the most, for another few days, the most senior teacher at the middle school, having started in 1970, so 36 years. And she's going to hand that cane or mantle off, I don't know which it is, to Buddy Earl after Friday. Also looking in her file, I found out that before she was hired here, her previous jobs were at the Dunlop Insurance Agency in 1968 and Deering Ice Cream as a waitress in 67. The information just flowed throughout this whole, and I'm not kidding you, Mary came in with a dolly. I asked for a file. Mary came in with a dolly, and I said, I didn't need the whole cabinet. She said, this is Mary. So that tells you how long someone's been in the school system. Mary has been teaching in the eighth grade throughout the vast majority of her time in education at the middle school, except she did teach a fifth grade once, and she told me that one time and said, once. I think that was enough. I figure that she spent about 6,500 days at school, and that's only counting if you figure that what a regular day is. Now, Mary, the two Marys have a different idea on what a day is, because it didn't matter if I said, I'm going to beat her to school today. I'm going to get there at 5:55. Nope, I would have had to get up at 5 o'clock, be there at 5 or 5:15. It's the reverse of that commercial about, we'll leave the light on for you. She turns the light on for you. She starts the day. She opens the school. She sets the coffee up. It's just, it's amazing. She's probably had, if I have this sort of right, about 3,200 students during her career. That's more than a lot of school systems in the state currently have for kids. She has served on every committee known to humankind, and all at the same time. Alan said to me earlier on this year, he said, so who are these Mary Murphys? Alan, that is one person. He said, no, it's not two people. I said, no, I swear to you, it's one person, Mary Murphy. So we're certainly going to miss her positive sense around the school, her extreme punctuality for everything she does, the kind of enthusiasm she has in her classroom, and her willingness to just be involved in any facet of the job. So I wish that Mary were here tonight, but as I talked to her about a couple of upcoming things, she just kind of nodded and said, thanks very much. So we wish her well. And now for the next person, Mrs. Carolyn Russ. Carolyn, would you mind coming up here and joining me? Sure. How are you tonight? This look familiar? The student voice. I was going to go have a chat with Carolyn and say, give me all the background facts. And the student voice beat me to it. So I'm going to give you some of the excerpts from the article here. She was asked questions about when she began here and what positions she's held and so forth. And she started teaching in Cape Elizabeth in 1980. She taught special education and the Project Challenge, which has since become known as the Accelerated Language Arts Program. And she's been in her current sixth grade language arts and social studies teacher position for the past 7 years. So when I last worked here, I think she and I were team partners and you were in special education at
right.
the time. So when I came back and I see this name on the class list, I'm saying, is she certified for that? So I guess the answer was yes. She started her teaching career in Maryland after earning her master's degree and taught eighth grade English there. And then after that, she spent several years at the International School of Bangkok, Thailand, teaching English to students of 35 different nationalities. Quite an experience. Some of the students asked her, so what are the biggest changes that you've seen over time? And three things that she mentioned. One was the building itself, gone through several iterations in that 25-year time span, 26. And the World Language Program going into the younger grades. And I will mention some details about that later on if I get the opportunity. And last thing in huge, huge capital letters here was the computer, the amount of technology that's come into the classroom that teachers just take for granted now as part of the way we do our work. And one of her memories that would stick out would be the medieval fair. I think anybody involved in that would say, I know what I did during that activity with kids. And she mentioned here about complete with jousting on real horses. The jousting was not for students. It was Andy Strout and some others that actually put on a replica joust in the backyard. That's why Andy has a limp. But during that, she taught a course, and I remember her doing this, in illuminating manuscripts, decorating text with gold and color, which was the way that the monks illustrated books of the time. So her plans in retirement are to include travel, spend more time with the grandchildren. Now, I knew the travel part because I kept saying to her, well, if in the schedule, if I could work out this kind of thing, would you be interested? Well, Joel really wants to travel, and he'd like me to go with him. So I guess that was out. And the grandchildren, now I know the grandchildren up in Damariscotta.
Those are they.
Okay, all right. And reading many books and learning to play the Celtic harp. So I did ask her to bring it with her tonight and give us a demonstration, but apparently that didn't happen. Carolyn, we're going to miss you.
Thank you.
Thanks for everything. And I told her I'm not going to forgive her for retiring so quickly on me.
Can I say?
Yes, please do say
okay.
Sports.
You can put your present. All right, I'll give you a hug.
Oh, miss you.
I miss you too. And I'm not going to say a lot because this is not my favorite thing to do. However, Steve, you didn't mention that we first met each other when you had my oldest son as a sixth grade student in one of the toughest sixth grades ever to pass through Cape Elizabeth. Not that he was, but in any case, we got to know each other then. The medieval day was interesting that you brought up that topic, although that was very good reading from the voice. You didn't have to do anything. I dug out a copy. They had a video of that in the library. Hayden Atwood, the librarian, had a video of the medieval day, and it did show the horses, and it was a great day. It was hectic, but we had a lot of fun. And the students said, why can't we do that? And I said, be prepared, Mr. Connolly, because guess what? They're going to ask you to do something like that next year. Had a lot of fun teaching here over the years. I as Steve said, been in a variety of positions. One of my colleagues who retired last year, Susie Van Wy, said, "Be prepared for a lot of celebrating," and I have certainly experienced that from the Cape Elizabeth Teacher Association dinner to my sixth grade colleagues fading me at one of their houses to most recently last Friday, and Trish Brigham had a lot to do with this, I know, when my two classes pulled off a great surprise and truly did surprise me with a very nice send-off party, and that was a lot of fun. I appreciated that, and I appreciated all that people have done. Thank you very much.
And Steve, would you take this for Mary and make sure that she gets it with the school board's appreciation? Thank you. Now, we have no one retiring from the high school, so Jeff gets out of this year. But wait for another year, we'll get him. We do, however, have one person who's system-wide, and that's our Director of Special Services, Claire LaBrie, about whom Alan was supposed to speak. And I'm sure he had written notes, but he didn't leave them for me. So I guess I have two options. I can go around the room and have everyone tell something they know about Claire, good or bad. Or I could say a few words about her. I have known Claire since her first day here, back when she was a new employee taking over for Wayne Doerr, who had been a much-loved special ed director by all of his staff. And they were sorry to see him go, and they were hard shoes for Claire to fill, but she has done it superbly. And this was her 10th year here in Cape Elizabeth. And during those 10 years, she has made lots of changes because of the special ed laws. She has very aptly introduced those changes as required by the law, and she has done it with a smile on her face and love in her heart. She loves the kids, she loves the teachers, she loves the central office staff, and I know she won't miss the paperwork either, but she will miss the people, I'm sure of that. And Claire, all I can say is we're sorry to see you go, we'll miss you, but we hope that you have lots of fun traveling and doing all of the things that you and Larry want to do. So if you just come forward, we do have a little gift of appreciation. And I'm sorry I didn't have any prepared words for you.
You did a lot better than I would have done. Right.
Congratulations.
Thank you. They have some money if I come up here and I go, yee-hoo! So I'm doing it because they are going to ask the town council.
Wait.
They're asking the town council for a 1% increase on the tax cap so they can give it to me. Let's go, guys. No, in all honesty, I am going to miss, I'm going to miss the job. There are some of the things on the job that I'm not going to miss, but I'm going to miss the people that I've had to work with, the kids, the parents, and like Janet, I will not miss the paperwork. And especially having to say to people, that has to be on my desk by 3 o'clock. I can't believe I'm not going to have to say that anymore. But we are planning some wonderful trips, and we're hoping to have a good long life together, Larry and I. So I'm excited. So thank you, guys.
I just want to say, Mary, you did a great job, yeah. Especially off the cuff. And
I just rehearsed all day.
Oh, no, you do very well. I think we'd just like to take a 10-minute break for some refreshments and in recognition of our retirees and our teachers' years of service. So at this point, we'll just take that 10-minute and we'll reconvene.
say, they need to be next. They're next.
You are, yes.
Great. Well, that was great. Thank you, Mary, for coordinating all the refreshments, and thank you for all the teachers who came. At this point, we'll pick up at item number 8, which is the superintendent's report, and I'd like to start off with introducing Jake from our high school and Lisa Johnson from Have a Heart, and they're here to speak about the program that was included in your packet that is proposed for a Costa Rica trip during next February.
Hi. I'm Jake Jackson, and I teach physical education at the high school, and this is Lisa Johnson, and she's representing Have Heart. And we're here to get your approval for a trip that will be happening next February vacation, and we, Carrie Apinovich, who teaches social studies, will also be going on the trip along with me, and hopefully we'll recruit about 18 students to go. And we'll be going to, it'll be a volunteer vacation, and we'll be staying at an Environmental Learning and Sustainable Living Center in Costa Rica. And we're hoping to connect their experience with, some of them are seniors, with the senior transition projects, so that they could come back and possibly work with the second grade at Pond Cove, who does, they do a big project in Costa Rica. So I've talked to one of the teachers in second grade, and we're maybe thinking that they could go have this experience in February and come back and work with some Pond Cove students. Or they could work at an environmental center like the Audubon Society or other projects on sustainable living in the community. So that's how, and then also there's a community service aspect that students need to complete in freshman and sophomore year. So this could actually be applied to that as well. So some of the things they'll be doing, I think you have a packet, are agroforestry, carpentry, building with cob and bamboo, English instruction to local students in the community school, some construction and maintenance of trails, and organic farming, gardening, cooking, cleaning, foundation work, and masonry. They're able to choose a project to work on either for the entire time, or they could choose different projects throughout their stay. So we'd like to go for 10 days, which means that we would need to miss 3 days of school because of the travel. It takes us a day to get there and a day to come home. And most, if you have their itinerary, a lot of it is actually working on site for like 5 or 6 hours a day to complete projects. And then we do take 2 days to go to a waterfall and a beach. But most of the time they're staying right there in, at the ranch. So this is a project that Lisa and her partner Karen from Have Heart founded. So she'll speak to any questions you have about that and the insurance pieces of that. Does anyone have any questions?
This doesn't connect in any way with Mark Mendarvis's usual trip.
No.
So then which students, how do students, who is this open to?
High school students.
Any high school students?
Right.
No, I was just going to ask if there were any more questions.
How many students do you expect to bring?
The ranch accommodates 20 people only, so we would be able to take 18.
Trish? This is probably a technical question, but this field trip policy is on my mind.
Mm-hmm.
Is this a school trip or a private trip?
This is a private.
Because it's not curriculum related.
Private, right?
And if it's private, if it is a private trip, our current policy that we're in the doing a second reading on says that the school department will neither approve nor disapprove the trip.
So I don't know. I'm just asking the question for discussion purposes.
I'm thinking the same thing, Trish, but I'm not sure how. I haven't looked at the policy again. Since it involves school days, does it still and I probably have this answer ready. The thing is, if it involves school days, does it still fall for us to approve or disapprove?
Yeah, I'm not sure, because that's what we've always done in the past. Yeah. But I'm not sure that actually that is stipulated in the new. Jeff, do you remember?
It says classroom time shall not be used to organize or participate in a privately sponsored trip. But by definition, is this privately sponsored or not? I guess that's the question.
I think in the past, and I honestly don't remember how this policy would impact, but I think what technically needs to be approved is the for Jake taking away herself for 3 days, because that's taking away her way from her classroom. I'm not sure that you need to approve it. I think it is essentially a private trip. It sounds like a word about community for kids, but it's essentially a private trip. But because it's taking place just before contractual vacation, at least in the past,
but then wouldn't we also be approving the time away from school for the kids?
Parents really have the ability to do that on their own without your permission. They could have a plan to ask themselves to go on any other factor.
But haven't we done that in the past?
We have in the past. One of the primary reasons it's come to us in the past was basically to bless the absence from school of the students, though I do agree with Jeff that Parents can make that decision unilaterally, regardless of what our policies might or might not say. And just by way of explanation, we do have a brand new policy on this, and it's not that we're trying to discourage or challenge so much as figure out how that fits in with a new policy that really took a lot of time to put together.
There's also the issue but participation in this travel program can be used towards community service credits for student senior transition projects. So I don't know if that, no, that other things that are privately done can be used towards that too, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
And I would think that's more a high school administration issue as opposed to a school board issue. We're just trying to define what our role is. Mm-hmm.
Right, because I don't think that in this new, we didn't, you know, really talk about that in this policy in terms of days off, you know, approving days off for private.
Well, let me piggyback on that, Ann, for a second. Another thing that's been an issue is liability on these trips. Now, do you have your own insurance for this trip?
Or we do. We're insured by Lloyd's of London, and I met with the Hendersons this morning in South Portland, and they said if the town of Cape Elizabeth or the high school wanted to be added on as additionally insured, they could do that. And
no, but you're not looking to us to cover this trip on our liability policy?
No.
You know, I'm just wondering if maybe what we should do, since Alan isn't here, is just, you know, hold off on this. I mean, we have the information and we have the packet because we do have this new policy and we're not, and, you know, the issue of your time off, I mean, it's not happening until the spring.
It's February, so there's a lot of time.
Okay.
Yeah.
February. I mean, I'm just wondering if that.
Well, it also makes sense, Ann, because of its position on the agenda tonight. It's not under new business, is it?
No, it's under report.
It is.
Then I missed it.
It's actually the very last item before we had the adjustments.
Well, so then I'm wondering if, have you had a discussion with Alan about?
Well, I've met with Alan, and he mentioned that this would be the earliest opportunity for us to come in, so he put us on the agenda. Because we would like to meet with, well, parents and students and kind of get things going, because we do need to.
Deadlines.
We have deadlines for the ticketing and.
Right. So we don't want to hold you up. I mean, then what that would mean is that we haven't really decided if we have a meeting in August or not. Right. So there may or may not be an August meeting, which means it could potentially be September. Mm-hmm. And that's 3 months off. So I don't know. Maybe not. I mean, maybe then we should just go ahead and, you know, give him the three. Yeah.
Yeah, because if Alan placed it on the agenda,
yeah, then
clearly his thinking is that it it needs our approval. And I'm not inclined not to give our approval.
And I don't see any harm in giving our approval or having the discussion and the opportunity for questions, and I'm not assuming that it has approval. We haven't seen the vote, but just assuming. And I just looking very quickly over the policy, basically, correct me, but it says that if it's a private trip and it's not an activity of the Cape Elizabeth School Department, the department assumes no liability. And then it goes on to say the school department will neither approve or disapprove the trip.
Right, so that's why I'm questioning whether...
So, well, it's just that we're giving...
What action do we need to take?
Yeah.
Well, we're just approving the time off.
And that's not laid out specifically in the current policy, in the new policy. But that's, yeah,
And again, it appears that Alan thinks that we should be voting on this because I missed it originally, but it is on the agenda, so let's just...
Yeah. Well, I guess, actually, if you read further, the board recognizes that travel may impact other program services in the general operation of the schools. To minimize the impact, the board does not approve absences for non-sanctioned trips that require staff to miss work days. So...
You have to sanction it.
That means we have to take action. We do have to sanction the trip in order for the work days to be...
To be missed.
That's confusing.
Yeah, so basically that means we can give approval to miss work days. I think we should just go ahead and give the approval.
But that comes later. Okay. Does anybody have any more questions or discussions regarding this issue before we move on to the next issue? And we will plan on taking a vote under new business.
Or can we move that vote ahead so they can go ahead? Yeah.
I move that we vote on consideration of the proposed trip to Costa Rica now.
Okay.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Kevin. Any discussion regarding the motion?
Just a clarification that if we do approve it, do we need to be added for liability? Do we then assume liability?
No. Not if there's existing insurance.
We're approving absence from school.
That's all. Okay. Thank you.
All those in favor? We have a 7-0 vote. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for waiting. Under the superintendent's report, we'd like to just give an opportunity for our principals just to come up, if they so choose, to share a few comments about the end of the school year. If we could start off with Steve, that would be great.
Thanks for the opportunity to share this information. First thing I'll start with is that last week we had our 8th grade recognition night, 143 students. It was a great first class for me to start off as principal of the middle school at. I was very impressed with the pieces that the parents had pulled together. The posters were wonderful, the videos, slideshows, great evening. In our life skills class, they had been volunteering at the Village Crossing this month and helped to paint a trellis for their garden. I don't know how they squeezed that in on a dry day. I don't remember one. maybe they did it indoors, I guess. In May, the life skills classes from all three schools put on a spaghetti dinner for the parents and staff. Also, Pam Bosa's grant to start the middle school garden that was mentioned earlier about the seed grants should have a great impact for those students next year. In the fifth grade, three science classes, that would be Quirk, Walsh, and Ramsbotham, had two very successful video conference sessions with the Bronx Zoo on adaptations. If you haven't seen the video conferencing equipment and what it can do, it's amazing technology. They had the technical assistance of Dean Zaharis, Holly Smevog, and Jill Bell. Also, the entire fifth grade recently participated in the Gulf of Maine Research Institute's program on the mystery of the X fish and visited that the Gulf of Maine Research Institute as well. Currently, we have a group of students who are down in University of Maryland at the national, representing the state of Maine in National History Day, our first opportunity, first effort at competing in this program. Sarah Welch is leading this group, and she received word before she left that she is one of 10 of the 10 national finalists for the National History Day Teacher of the Year Award, which she should hear about this coming, I think it's the 15th. So good luck to Sarah and to our students. In art, we have a PAL grant. I'm stuck on Police Athletic League, and I know that's not it. It's a PAL, PAL grant, that Marguerite Lalaroner wrote, and that is for visiting sculptors to help with sculpture gardens in the courtyard that will add to our gardens that we're going to have out there, turning that into a useful, user-friendly place. Our visiting teacher from Thailand, Makaranon Wichapan, worked for the third trimester with sixth graders in art, and we're going to be hosting a Japanese intern, Ms. Hiyori Fukagawa, starting September 16th and going through March 16th of next year. National winners Conrad Berthiaume has coached me on this, Le Grand Concours. So I hope I said that correctly. The National French Exam, we had students in our school, for instance, I'll read off the names, but as the prime example of this, Peter Brigham finished first in the state on this exam and second in the nation. Nationally, Devin Bottomley and Gabe Donahue finished fifth, Hannah Doss, Holly McIntyre, seventh, Will Lewandowski was eighth, Jimmy Haller, Jay Cushing, Kristen Kearney, Morgan Pillsbury, and Kylie Tanabe finished ninth, Grant Backer, Bailey Dietrich, Madeline Spagnolo, and Colleen Whitcomb finished 10th, national French exams. And then I got the information from Spanish that says that Lauren Katsos and John Menz finished 8th in the state. And I was looking at this going, 8th in the state? What happened? And then it reminds me here, don't forget, this is outstanding because these are students who are in the non-FLES program, which means that they switched from French to Spanish last year. So been a very successful trimester, and we're looking forward to more things in the fall. Thanks.
Thank you, Steve. Great news and great way to end the school year. So thank you. Tom, you have anything else?
First, I'd be remiss if I didn't once again thank the PCPA for Arts Day number 3 last month. It was an amazing event. Well, Ann, I think you know about it. We had 35 local artists and over 150 parent volunteers to pull off this day. It was just, we call it zero day at school because every kid had at least one art experience. It was a fabulous day. We really appreciate that support. Also, at our last faculty meeting of the year, it's hard to remember, everybody's so busy at the end of the year, the things we've accomplished. So Becky Swift led us through a little exercise of personal triumphs, team triumphs, and school-wide ones. And the consensus about the school-wide achievement was getting Becky Swift. We now have the teacher leadership back on track, and we had 7 or 8 or 9, 10, maybe up to 10 teachers participate in that process, and I think it just set a good standard for the school. Along with that, this has been the first year we've done a more formal induction process. So Shari Robinson and Becky did that, and it's just made a tremendous difference, not just for the new teachers, but for the teachers changing grade levels. They've gotten more support than they've had before. They've gotten around to visit classrooms. It's just been terrific. And that brought to mind that our hiring process seems to have worked because we're really thrilled with the new teachers. A few other things, we're still working hard about trying to increase get better the way we teach reading. 2 or 3 grade levels are working specifically on comprehension. We're going to do that next year. And I also want to thank our teacher assistance team. It's been in working 8 or 10 years now. That team helps students who need help on either for kids who are challenging the curriculum or challenged by the curriculum. It's essentially a volunteer group. They work very closely with special ed, and I think with talk about reducing paperwork. I think that team has done a terrific job, and we expect more from them in the future. So thanks.
Great. Thank you, Tom. Yeah. Jeff?
I just want to mention a few things, and I'm working from memory. First of all, I want to thank the entire class of 2006, because after we said, good prank, you got us, please don't do another one, they didn't do another one. So that was very cool. And that was sort of one of the topics that was mentioned by some students at the senior celebration and by me at graduation and at the senior celebration. It was a really classy class in a lot of ways, and we are going to miss them. The theater group had several successful performances. Perhaps some of you saw one of the performances of The Boyfriend. It's a relatively, I'd never heard of it before, but it was very entertaining. There was very skillful dancing and singing on display, and it was a good show. I wanted to mention, because not everybody sort of in earshot or TV shot of this has probably heard about the students who were awarded the citizenship awards at graduation ceremonies, the seniors in particular. And I've been sitting back there and thinking, I know there was 8 and I've got 7, but I decided I'm going to list them anyway, and then at some future time I will remember, okay, who was the 8th person. Mike Curtis received the Phoenix Award for showing the most improvement. Academically and in other ways at the high school over the course of 4 years. Mary Catherine Huebner, the School Spirit Award, Allie Donahue, Determination and Achievement, Grace Needleman, Good Samaritan Award, John Butterworth, another Spirit Award, Kevin Harrison for Excellence, and Anna Stressinger for another Good Samaritan Award as well. And I will get that last one. I'm hoping the person's name will come to me before I sit down, but I fear it may not. We had an excellent project graduation. I want to thank the project graduation parents, of whom there are way too many to mention, but it's really an amazing undertaking that literally fundraising and organization extends over the entire year, and it's just such a great gift that the community and the parents give to our students so that they remain safe, but more importantly, I think, so that they can bond for one last time before they leave the Cape School community. And we had some wonderful presentations by several students, again, doing from memory, and I'm not going to hit them all, but who, in front of the entire student body, 9th through 11th graders, stood up and talked about, shared some of the things that they had done at their senior transition project. And there are some frustrating aspects of the senior transition project every year, and then you get to the end and you hear and see and listen to the excitement that they brought, the things that they learned, and that sort of thing. And it is quite amazing. Anna Stressinger, whose name I mentioned, shared a wonderful presentation about her experience doing some bird banding in connection with the Audubon Society. And she and I, on the project graduation bus down to Boston, I was asking her opinion about the release of the doves and whether they were correctly confined and some other things in cages, and she said it looked okay to her. But she did. She did a wonderful job. Abby Terrio did a wonderful job talking to students about her work in Olympia Snow Center, Senator Snow's office in Portland. Kevin Clark did a nice job presenting to students about his work at a local sports agent's office during his 3-week transition project. And there were several other students who presented as well. It's become a nice tradition to give the younger students sort of a glimpse of what a quality senior transition project can be. So it was really very exceptional, I think.
Great.
That's it.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you.
It's a really busy time of the year, and there's a lot of stuff that goes on, and I'm glad we took the opportunity just to remember and share some of those things. So I thank you for getting up at the last minute and sharing that. If I could ask Kevin to report on an update on the kids' turf.
Sure.
That would be great.
for those who may not know or don't recall, there is a citizens group in town called Kids Turf, which has plans to raise $650,000 to install an artificial turf field where our lower soccer field currently exists. They approached us some time ago with a presentation, and us being the school board, asked our permission to proceed to the council, and we gave that permission. Subsequently, the board discovered that they had a more significant role in that than ever before. The board met, and one of our recommendations was to form a joint working group of the town council, the school board, and the citizens group, along with some independent citizens. That was approved last night by the council. Amongst the items on our charge is to work with Kids Turf to develop the construction permit plan, how to raise funds, developing a plan of possibly naming the field, determining who the artificial turf vendor would be, which one would be selected, and so on. A lot of it very financial in nature. But the nature of the project also will require policy issues to be addressed by the school board as well. Things are moving along. We do not have the committee assembled yet. I believe that there will be members of the board recommended for appointment tonight, and then hopefully things will move quickly along towards finalizing that committee so we can get to work on the project. That's about where we are as of this very moment.
Great. Thank you for the update. Mary, would you mind talking about the facilitator of curriculum and professional development position?
Yes. Sarah Simmons, who's our facilitator of curriculum and professional development, has asked for a half-year leave of absence next year in order to pursue completing her doctorate. That was granted by the school board at an earlier meeting this year. We advertised in-house for a teacher who was interested in assuming half of her position for next year. Sarah and Alan met quite extensively to determine the list of things that Sarah would continue doing and the list that her other half would do and the things that they might work on together. We had several applicants, one from out of district and several from in district, and the selection was made, and Shari Robinson, who is currently our Pond Cove librarian, will be sharing her position in the library next year and will be sharing Sarah's position. So we're looking forward to that working very well. They have a wonderful working relationship already. They serve together on the curriculum committee, and it was mentioned earlier that they had done some work together in another area. So they know each other well, they work together well, and we're looking forward to a smooth transition to a shared position for the year. And then Sarah will assume her position again after she completes her doctorate.
Great. And last item on the superintendent's report is a reminder to school board members that we're going to be flipping burgers on June 16th, which is the last day of school. And we have invited all staff from our schools to come on out after the students have gone home. Behind the Pond Cove gym in the L off the back of the cafeteria and celebrate a little bit about regarding the end of the school year. So I think that's we'll pray for good weather and hopefully we'll see everybody then.
And if the weather doesn't cooperate, we will go to the cafetorium.
Yeah, great. We'll move along to committee reports. We'll start off with Finance Committee. Rebecca?
At our last meeting, we reviewed the energy report, and everything was basically in line with what had been projected. We did discuss the process of reimbursement to the schools for pool energy costs, and I believe that Pauline is going to follow up with Ernie to get a clearer understanding of how the oil reimbursement is calculated. We really couldn't come up with a firm understanding of what that was based on. The electricity is much more simple. There's a separate meter for the pool, and that's what is measured twice a year. And so that's energy. Food report was also in line with what we had seen previously. No issues were highlighted. And then we had a lengthy discussion with Connie Goldman, who is Cape Elizabeth's representative in Augusta. She wanted to share with us some concerns that she had about what she saw during the legislative session this year and what she thinks we're going to be facing next year. In particular, she noted, as I've heard from other people, that there is a very big divide between the rural north representatives, counties, municipalities, and the south. That comes into play around school funding in particular. And the way that it's being played out right now is that during this past legislative session, a great deal of effort was put into advocating removing the cost of living adjustment in the EPS formula. So as it currently stands, there are several different groupings for cost of living, and then how much we are funded. It depends on how we are, where we lie in the groups. Now, obviously, since we're in the South, we have a grouping that is gives us a compensation because we have a higher cost of living than, per se, up in the northern counties. There was a proposal that was narrowly defeated to reduce all of those to one adjustment. So everybody would get the same adjustment, which would be no adjustment. She sees that that is going to come back again next year. The people who propose this elimination of the adjustment are very well organized. They actually have a coalition. They have been meeting with the legislators and the committees. And during our discussion at the Finance Committee, we touched on the fact that perhaps we really need to pay some more direct attention to this issue and reach out to other communities, not just in Cumberland County, but York and other coastal Maine counties, because we all are experiencing similar valuation issues and cost of living issues. I believe that's it for the Finance Committee report.
Thank you, Rebecca. Planning Committee, Trish?
We had a brief meeting on May 23rd where we discussed the agenda for the workshop on future directions plan, which the school board had. Alan reported that he and Sarah Simmons were going to be talking to the staff about the future direction plan at various faculty meetings. We discussed plans for the year-end staff barbecue, which Elaine referred to. We don't have any meetings set up at this point, but we will, so we can begin to talk about some of the community dialogue day and some of the other initiatives for the future direction plan.
Thank you. Policy Committee, Ann.
The Policy Committee met on May 16th. The first item we discussed was policy JLCEA, which is managing student allergies. And some of you may remember that a year ago we had this policy that we approved, and at the time what we said is that we would do a one-year review of the policy as well as the guidelines within each of the three schools. So this was the one-year point. And in our discussions, we found that the policy has seemed to work well in each of the three schools, and the committee's not recommending any kind of changes to that. For the guidelines, we took a look at both the Pond Cove and the middle school. We didn't, nobody seemed to feel that the high school, at least at this point, needed to have their guidelines reviewed. Jeff's shaking his head, so that's correct. There's a group of parents, I believe all of whom have children who have severe allergies, and that's called FAST, the Food Allergy Support Team. Those parents had met both with Tom and Steve to go over the guidelines in those two schools. And based on some of the discussions, a few pieces of the guidelines were changed at Pond Cove, and a couple of things were also revised at the middle school. And then the other things we talked about are the four policies that we'll be presenting later this evening for second reading. So I don't think I really need to, it makes more sense to just go over that at that time.
Okay, thank you. Kathy, Personnel Committee.
Did you
covered the wellness part, too? I'm sorry.
You skipped wellness. Oh, I'm sorry. Let's go back to wellness.
Okay, so the wellness subcommittee, that's a subcommittee of the policy committee, met on May 25th. And Sue King is a member of that committee. She had just attended a conference that was talking about some of the changes that are coming down state and federal level for nutrition guidelines within lunch programs. And she reported that based on, actually she had already implemented some of the things that they were talking about at that conference, which were things such as increasing grains in our lunch program and decreasing portion sizes. Then we talked about the survey, which I mentioned last month. The survey is online. It's on our school website. I dropped by and got the numbers from Steve yesterday, who is sort of compiling everything, from Dean Zaharis, who is our technology guru, who's collecting all the information that's coming through. And we are surveying students, parents, staff, you know, basically everybody can take the survey, but they're different surveys. It's by school level as well as by the category of the, you know, person who's filling it out. So I think we're going to get some really great information. We really had a number of people respond to the survey. Lots of kids. Some of the classrooms have really taken it on in certain grades, which is great. I think we'd love to have more high school kids take a look at that. So I would just urge people who are watching to, you know, go online. If you'd like to have input regarding our school lunch program, this is your opportunity. So really, we're going to be reviewing those surveys at our next meeting in a couple of weeks. So please do that. And then we started to tackle the policy itself. MSMA has done a draft policy, a sample policy, and we're just beginning the process of going through that.
Thank you. Now, Kathy.
The Personnel Committee met on May 22nd. We were working on more job descriptions. We reviewed 10 more, and they are in our packets tonight. We distributed them out to the board so they could have advanced look with some questions and so forth. The job descriptions that we have left to do are ed techs and the teacher leader position. The personnel committee also reviewed non-union central office staff salaries and increases, and looked to Alan and Pauline for recommendations. We discussed the partial performance appraisal for the superintendent and how we were going to be handling that. And the next meeting is scheduled for June 26th at 1 o'clock in the Jordan Conference Room.
Thank you, Kathy. Rebecca, anything on communications?
I apologize. I don't remember when we met.
June 1st.
Oh, June 1st we met. And most of our conversation was centered around trying to come up with a template that could be used as a budget fact sheet, so the school district would not have to reinvent the wheel time in and time out, and could be perhaps shared with the public on a more timely basis. We did find a template online from another district in another state that we thought was interesting, and over the summer I think we'll try to play around with that and have something ready for the board to look at next fall, to be ready to have. We also discussed the need for having what we so ineloquently called the Public Information Plan, or PIP, but that we probably needed to, as a board, agree to something in the fall that we could then follow throughout the year, so we wouldn't things wouldn't slip as deadlines became tighter and tighter. So that's also something we will be looking at come the early fall. And we will not be having any more meetings until the fall.
Okay. Thank you. Under non-board committees, legislative liaison.
Right.
Skip Kevin, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Jumping down, I heard the... Rebecca, you want to take a break?
Yes, I do.
Kevin, can you speak to the student extracurricular committee?
Yes, so our last meeting centered primarily around recognizing one of the sports teams, and that will be dealt with on the new business. Other than that, our membership was stolen away. One was facilitating the end of the final lacrosse game, and because Jeff was tied down with other things. The other topic that we've been dealing with lately is policy recommendations, as well as the kids' turf situation. It's becoming clearer and clearer that a lot of the policies that we would normally be reviewing and passing along to policy with a recommendation really tied up in some of this kids' turf stuff. So we're going to take a step back and let that proceed. The kids' turf issues proceed first before we start mucking around with existing policies. The only other thing that we'll be doing is looking to update the coach's handbook once those policies are in fact reviewed and put into place, which would include one of the policies that we're voting on tonight.
Okay. Rebecca, would you like to speak about the legislative liaison position?
Sure. Well, quite a bit was discussed under the Finance Committee. I would like to request that some direction be given to the concept of reaching out to other communities and perhaps creating our own coalition. I don't know by what mechanism we need to do that, but I think it's becoming critically clear to me how much of an impact what goes on in Augusta has on what happens here. And we perhaps need to become much more proactive than what we have been. Lastly, tonight you will notice that there is a resolution to be voted on in relation to Tabor, so I'll talk about it at that point.
Okay, thank you. PASS General Advisory Committee, Kevin.
PASS ended their school year on May 19th with the graduation of most of their second year students. I'd like to congratulate all the CAPE students who either went to PASS or graduated on May 19th for their good hard work at that institution. Nothing else.
Thank you. Just a brief note regarding the town's comprehensive plan committee. This Thursday night on June 15th, here in council chambers, there will be a public forum. And the committee has been working hard on revising a variety of chapters. At this time, they will be discussing and looking for public feedback on the economy, housing, transportation, marine resources, water resources, and critical natural resources. They will also be discussing recreation, which is one of the chapters that did involve a discussion of community services, and also involves discussion regarding field needs and field usage and courts, that type of thing, within the community. So there are some things that we are quite familiar with that the committee will hear public feedback on. So I do invite you for that forum. On July 27th, there will be a town comprehensive plan committee meeting. And at that time, Alan and I will be presenting a draft for their consideration on public facilities, which basically includes the use of our schools, and fiscal capacity, which really is quite a far-reaching chapter, but directly, of course, impacts the amount of money that's available for funding for our schools. So that is an important date. And that will be followed by a public forum in January of 2007, or 2007, in which the public will again be invited to give feedback on that chapter regarding the schools. So I just wanted to share that with the board. We have some unfinished business, and I'll move on to Ann for consideration of policies for a second reading.
Okay, so the first one is GCSA-R, which are the guidelines to the employee computer and internet use rules. Let's see, so what was changed on here? We went back, this went back to the policy committee for more discussion around a couple of items. Both under prohibited uses on the second page. Number four, I think, and number five. Well, we removed the word political in term that was going to be added to the list of things that would not be allowed, any kinds of political discussions. And then under number four, there was some discussion. We had originally inserted parent association, the term parents association, into the list, but we actually ended up rewording that entire paragraph to kind of broaden it a little bit, thereby not singling out any one group in particular. And those are the two changes that are on here from the first reading. So are there any questions or thoughts on that?
We need a motion.
Yes, fine, we have a motion to accept policy GCSAR as presented.
Yeah, and we don't actually usually vote on guidelines, but under the circumstances, because we were asked to do these guidelines, I think maybe that makes sense. Typically, we don't do that.
Okay. Thank you, Kevin. Second?
Second.
Rebecca? Thank you. Discussion?
Actually, I had a question for you. I was wondering why we didn't cross-reference anything to do with the volunteer policy, IJOC. You know, that at one time, that was something that was questioned, and that's, I think that's partially why, at one point, the parent associations were included in that one paragraph and then removed. But I'm wondering what's the rationale behind us excluding at least a cross-reference to the volunteer policy to show that any volunteers fall under these internet guidelines as well.
I don't know, Linda. I don't really remember any, conversation about that. Cross-referencing in the body of the guidelines?
No, just a cross-reference at the end of the...
Oh, probably because, I'm not sure, but because this was a brand new, set of guidelines that Gary got from MSMA, maybe it just wasn't in there, but, if there's something that we need to add to cross-reference, we should certainly do that.
Okay. Do you have any suggested wording that you would like to see?
Actually, I was just referring to having a cross-reference at the end of the policy as it cross-references the GSA.
Oh, last page.
I see.
On the last
okay.
page.
So we could put to add, to be sure, I guess what we could put is just to be sure that we've cross-referenced anything that's really pertinent.
Kevin?
Yes. One of my original concerns with taking out the word political was the question of whether or not in Maine state law, whether under school law or any other law, that there was some sort of prohibition about the schools or the school's property being engaged in political activity. I did some seriously extensive research on that with help from outside organizations. And in fact, there is no law, whether it's under education law or general law in the state of Maine, that prohibits such activity. That was number one. Number two is, this is an employee computer and internet use rules, and we should not be mixing in other groups into a policy that relates specifically and was written specifically for employees. We do, however, have the right to limit employees' use of the computer for non-educational purposes. And I've decided that in looking at access to school computers, networks, and internet services, page 1, section B, and on page 1, section C, acceptable use, and D, personal use, that those adequately cover concerns that I had. So that's primarily it, and I will be voting in support of this policy.
Thank you, Kevin. Kathy?
I had the same concern, maybe not the same as Kevin has stated, but I think as I stated at the policy committee about deleting the word political under prohibited uses. And as I stated, you know, at the committee, I was outvoted, and that's fine, that I thought it should stay in there and not be removed. And I still feel strongly about that, so I'll be voting against this policy or this guideline.
Any other comments or questions for this specific policy? Okay. This time we'll take a vote. All those in favor of accepting GCSAR? One, two, three. Six. All those in favor? Opposed. Thank you. One. That'd be 6-1.
Next policy is HF, Board Negotiating Agents. And this actually remains as is. When it was presented for first reading, it was sent back, and the committee was asked to discuss the first, actually, who should really do the recommending for the members of the negotiating team. There was some discussion that it might perhaps be the personnel committee chair, but we looked at our other policies and the appointments to other committees, and we wanted to remain consistent in our process of appointments and determine that that consistency would call for having the chair of the board do the recommendation, and then the full board would be voting on that recommendation. So I'd like to move that the board adopt policy HF, Board Negotiating Agents, as presented here.
Thank you, Kevin. Any questions or comments regarding this policy?
Just a quick comment that I was originally part of the group recommending other than what is here. However, it is consistent with the chair recommending appointments to other committees, and until such time as the structure of the personnel committee has changed, I will be supporting this policy as written.
Thank you, Kevin. Any other comments? Seeing none, all those in favor of this HF policy? 7-0.
In policy IHOA, student travel and field trips is the next one, and there were no changes or no request to discuss any pieces of this policy in any more detail when we presented this for first reading. So what you have here before you is what was presented for first reading. So I'd like to move that the board adopt policy IHOA, student travel and field trips, as presented here.
Second. Thank you, Rebecca. Any questions, comments? Kevin?
I'm a little concerned at what happened tonight with the Costa Rica trip, and I think what I would like to do is have the opportunity to consult and clarify around that issue that we face tonight, and would ask that you consider tabling it for discussion with the administrators.
So you mean the asking for days off piece, having that not?
I want to understand, because I heard everything Trish that was saying, and it kind of what was a conflict for me was clearly what the policy says and what Alan intended for us to do tonight, or at least what I think he intended us to do tonight, were two different things. And I'm a little concerned, and I think that if we're going to do this, we might as well get that piece of it understood. and make sure that there's no inconsistency in what we're being asked to do versus the policy we're going to adopt. I don't want to get caught, any of us, the board, to get caught in a trap because we overlook things. Because the more I think of it, the more I'm wondering if we accepted de facto liability by saying it was okay. And, you know, you don't have to, you know, they can have all the insurance in the world, but we know, contemporary history tells us that you sue everybody around you when there's a negative event. So I just think I'm looking at the board's safety and the school district's safety. I think it was a great job. If this hadn't happened tonight, I would definitely be voting against it. But I would ask you for your consideration of that.
Okay, well, given that, I'll withdraw my motion.
Okay. So do we have a motion to send this particular policy back, or are you just going to withdraw
it? I'll just withdraw it, and then we'll, you know, note that the policy committee will look at this when we meet in 2 weeks.
May I just make one comment?
Sure.
I promise I'll be quick. I think this is workable. I think what we've experiencing is becoming familiar with the policy and how to use it. As I read through this document, certain things are coming to light to me that maybe we didn't have to vote on and probably shouldn't have voted on it. So it's probably just more about just having the conversation as a board one more time about what we vote on, what we don't vote on, rather than necessarily being a policy, rewriting of a policy. But I do think it would be helpful for all of us to spend some quality time with this policy, because we do see a lot of this activity as a board. So anyways, that's just my comment.
Okay.
All right, and the last policy is JICH, which is the substance abuse policy. And there is just one change. Trish, what page is that on?
Five. And it's in red.
Do you want to say anything about that as chair of that committee?
No, we did at our last, at the policy committee meeting, actually, to address some concerns that came out. We have added the sentence that there will be an additional meeting for parents and students before the winter athletic season begins to respond to the concern that if we're making a meeting mandatory for students and to participate in extracurricular activities, that we should attempt at least initially to accommodate as many people as we can. And we will evaluate the policy in a year to see how it's working and whether or not it is necessary to require our administrators to do that.
So in that case, I'll make a motion that the board approve policy JICH, substance abuse, as presented here with the change, with the one change as written.
Thank you, Kevin. Any questions or comments?
Just that this was a great piece of work.
Thank you. Kathy?
I just wanted to say thank you to Trish and her group, the large group that she chaired, because I went to a few of those meetings, and they just did amazing work. And there was so much input from everybody. And one minute they'd think that they'd covered everything, and then somebody would bring something up, and it would open up a whole new page of information. And I just wanted to say thank you for all the work they did.
Thank you. For a vote, all those in favor? 7-0. We'll move along to new business. Consideration of job descriptions from the Personnel Committee.
In your packets, you will find, I'm sure you've taken a look at and perused extensively, 10 new job descriptions that the Personnel Committee has recommended to the board. Again, as you may recall from last month, we try to be consistent with the format that we've used. There's been a tremendous amount of work done on these. Sue Weatherby and Pauline and Alan and the district leadership folks who these job descriptions have gone back and forth with and so forth and so on, and then some additional questions were raised by some board members, which were great. I don't know if anybody else has any additional questions, and I don't know if this is how you'd expect me to do it, but I guess I would move that we accept the job descriptions as are presented in your package.
Okay. Second. Thank you, Kevin. Any comments or questions regarding the specifics of these descriptions?
Well, I'm just going to copy you and say thank you to the Personnel Committee, to Pauline and Sue and the DLT for doing this work. This is really important to the work of the schools, and it's going to be great to have as a tool moving forward. So, well done.
These will be finding their way to the website as well as the ones from last month.
Okay.
I'm not sure if they are there yet. I don't know if you, do you know, Pauline, if the ones from last month are on the website yet? I think we were going to try to package them all up together and get them, but they will get on the website so that if people want to go and look at, you know, what does a teacher do, what does this person do, that person, they can go in, which will be really helpful, you know, for consistency purposes going forward. So, and of course, they're always subject to change when people find things that should be added or subtracted, but at least they'll be there as a starting point.
Thank you. Great. It's time for a vote. All those in favor accepting these job descriptions? 7-0. Consideration of the superintendent's nominations of new teachers.
I think I have them in the right order. The first is a math teacher at the high school, Christine Newell. Chris was with us several years ago as a teacher, and she has 24 years teaching experience in various positions. Seven of them were here in Cape Elizabeth. She comes highly recommended, and she's being nominated to take over the position of math teacher at the high school.
Thank you. Do I have a motion to accept that recommendation?
So moved.
Thank you. A second? Kathy, any questions? Seeing none, all those in favor of recommendation? 7-0.
The next is another teacher at high school for a science position, teaching chemistry, Dr. Sharon Diorsi. She comes highly recommended. And the committee recommended her unanimously for this position.
Thank you. Do I have a motion?
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation for Sharon Dorsey.
Thank you. Second. Kevin. Any questions, comments? Seeing none, all those in favor of this recommendation? 7-0.
The next is another high school recommendation for another high school teacher. This is a one-year position to replace a teacher who will be on a one-year leave of absence. Recommending Erin Cavallero. She has 5 years of experience teaching English and is the unanimous recommendation of the committee. The superintendent's nomination.
Thank you. A motion?
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation to hire the high school teacher, Erin Cavallero.
Thank you. A second? Trish? Questions? Seeing none? All those in favor of this recommendation? 7-0.
The next recommendation is for an administrative position, the assistant principal at the high school, recommending, the superintendent is nominating, I'm saying it for him, I'm not making the nomination, but I'm reading it for him, nominating Troy Henninger. Troy has a background as a teacher and an administrator and is the unanimous recommendation of the committee.
Thank you. Do I have a motion to accept this recommendation? Trish?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Thank you. And questions or comments?
Can I just say something?
Yes, please do.
And I've introduced him to a couple of you at the board meeting tonight, but this is Troy Henninger, who's the gentleman that you're voting on. I just wanted to point him out so you can attach a name to a face to a name. That's right.
Thank you, Jeff.
I'm just wondering if Troy would like to come up just so viewers could see
him. Come on up. So this is Troy Henninger. He has outstanding teacher credentials, very, very, very highly referenced. It's rare to call people for references and get as glowing recommendations for his teaching background, his curriculum leadership, his assistant principal background, and I think we're very lucky to have him become the assistant principal, assuming you approve that nomination.
I'm very excited to be here. I really look forward to the journey and working together, and it should be a lot of fun.
And we're looking forward to having you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We need to take a vote. All those in favor of accepting the superintendent's recommendation for Troy Henninger as vice principal of the high school? 7-0. Thank you, Troy, and to the committee, and welcome. We look forward to working with you. That was item D. Do we want to go back now to consideration of change of status for current staff members?
I might make a comment first.
Kevin, yes.
To the administrators, I was very impressed in looking over the credentials of your candidates that were forwarded on by Alan. And I certainly hope that when we finish this hiring cycle, that the board will get to meet all of our new employees.
Thank you. All right. We also have as item number C, a consideration of change of status for current staff members. Alan?
I think one of those was Shari Robinson being changed to halftime.
Yeah, it's on the agenda.
It is here. So why don't I read it off the agenda, because it wasn't included in the packet. Lisa Melanson from 0.6 to full-time in high school English and the Achievement Center. Nicole Ball from 0.5 to full-time at our kindergarten. And Shari Robinson to 0.5 librarian and 0.5 curriculum staff development. Do I have a motion to accept this change of status?
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation of change of status for Lisa Melanson, Nicole Ball, and Sherry Robinson.
Thank you. A second? Kathy? Any other questions? Seeing none, all those in favor? 7-0. Item number E, consideration of an athletic trip request. Yes, please.
Okay, we have a request from Mark Tinkham for Kevin Harvey, who's the coach of the girls' varsity soccer team. You should have had it in your packet.
It is, yeah.
The trip would be taking place August 18th through the 19th. They'll be staying overnight in Hanover, New Hampshire for the regional preseason tournament. There'll be no cost to the school department. They're just seeking approval to go.
At this point, I would suggest that we have a motion to allow this trip, athletic trip.
I move that we allow the athletic trip. However, this I would say that this is another issue that needs clarification desperately. This one's not even during the school year. But I will move to approve the trip under the current circumstances.
Second?
Second.
Thank you, Ann. Comments or questions?
I just have a question. I'm the field trip ogre tonight. I apologize. On this new policy, I don't know how to do this, but having just gone through this on another situation, it says that I guess my question is, how many students are going? Our new policy, if we approve it, says if there are more than 12 students, it needs to be by licensed carrier. This trip lists parents as the drivers, which is okay if there's 12 or fewer students and they sign a liability waiver. So I apologize for bringing up all these questions, but I don't
do we approve it? If we don't have a policy, if it's in conflict with our policy, I don't know.
Well, the policy has now gone back for further discussion, so we're working off our existing policy. This is a trip that we've traditionally done, or the soccer team has traditionally done. I'm not saying that your questions aren't good ones, but I am tempted to go by our old policy and track record on this.
And Trish, that's the basis for my motion, but I agree. And again, I think this is why that policy needs to be looked at, not so much rewritten, but just understood. Because this one even more screams out that we shouldn't be approving it. It's not even within the school year. And it does involve private transportation.
But this is within the preseason soccer season, preseason season.
Yeah,
but it's not, you know, I agree, and that's the fine points that we have to come to agreement on.
But I think Trish raises another issue, I mean, the issue that you raised of the under 12 or over 12, you know, students and, you know, riding in private cars versus licensed transportation. So, I mean, I think that that's something that we should take another look at when we look at the policy yet again.
And when we do come to an understanding, we need to share it.
With
administration and staff, so we're all on the same page.
Good point. Okay. We have a second, and any further questions, comments? Seeing none, all those in favor of allowing this athletic trip? 7-0. Consideration of proposal to grant the superintendent authority to hire over the summer. A little background, the school board does not normally meet during the month of July and early August, and there is the potential for some hiring to occur, so this allows the superintendent to do that hiring. Do I have a motion to accept this proposal?
I move that we authorize the superintendent to make hiring decisions while the board is not meeting, subject to board approval when we do meet in September or August, whenever that happens.
Second? Kathy? Questions? Seeing none, all those in favor? 7-0. Consideration of the superintendent's recommendations to co-curricular fee positions for 2006-2007.
All right, first of all, for Pond Cove School, we have Catherine Cornell. These are team leaders. Those are the only co-curricular positions at the elementary school. So the team leaders Tom is recommending are Catherine Cornell for kindergarten, grade 1, Karen Dow, grade 2, Sarah Lewis, grade 3, Mary Dulac, grade 4, Christine Tweedy, Allied Arts, Marie Hayes, and PST, which is well, you all know what the PST is, the student assistance team.
What is
pupil services team. Special services. My brain's gone dead. I come early in the morning. I don't stay up late at night.
Might we standardize acronyms across schools?
That's right. That acronym threw me for a moment. I'm sorry. Like I said, I get up early in the morning. I don't stay up late at night. Susie Safer for pupil services team.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We have a motion to accept the recommendation. Thank you, Kevin. Second. Linda, any questions? All those in favor? 7-0.
Okay. Next, we have a co-curricular position, a system-wide one for Wendy Jerzowick to be the webmaster for the 2006-2007 school year.
The motion?
Moved.
Thank you, Kevin. Second. Trish.
Any questions?
Is this a new position?
No.
No, she's been doing it.
It's renewed annually, I believe.
I just don't remember seeing this. Okay.
In any event, just a comment.
Yes, Kevin?
Thank Wendy for the solid work she's been doing for us all year.
Great. All those in favor? 7-0. We have consideration of superintendent's recommendations.
I have another one that was left out of the packet accidentally, if you would consider hearing it. If not, we can table it for the next school board meeting. We have a system-wide curriculum committee. And it's being recommended that Pond Cove representative to that committee would be Mary Dulac, the middle school representative, Gary Record, the high school representative, Joyce Bell, and the system-wide CEEA representative would be Ellen Brady.
Thank you, Kevin.
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Any questions?
This is the curriculum committee?
No, this is the certification.
Certification.
Committee. I'm sorry. I said it wrong. It's the certification committee. It's the same committee that all the members are the same except the system-wide one was Shari Robinson. Since she won't be in the CEA anymore, she is stepping down from that position, and Ellen Brady has been recommended to take her place. And the middle school representative is different because Mary Murphy was that representative, and she has retired, so Gary Record is taking her place.
Okay.
Sorry, that was my mistake.
Okay. I had a motion from Kevin to accept that.
And a second.
A second? Mm-hmm. Linda? Any questions, further questions? Seeing none, all those in favor? 7-0. Any more
for
co-curricular?
We have more. We have more in our packet.
Oh, sorry.
Two sheets.
Okay, I'm sorry. I had an athletic one mixed in. We have more. We have from the high school and the middle school, the student ones. Those were the non-student co-curricular activities, co-curricular fees. These are the student activity. You have to excuse me. Again, I tell you, I get up early in the morning. I go to bed early at night. From the middle school, we have the following co-curricular recommendations. Band director, grades 5-8, Terry White. Instrumental music director, Terry White. Choral director, Rebecca Bean. Outdoor experience, grade 5, Kathy Walsh. Grade 6, Gary Record. Grade 7, Joanne Parquette. Grade 8 is not being recommended at the time. We have nobody for that position at this point. Speech for grades 5-8, Margaret Welch. Newspaper, grades 5-8, Pam Vose and Deborah Hannon. Yearbook, grades 5-8, Kathy Clough. The computer club, Brian Fischero. The speech, Margaret Welch. Math club, Brian Fischero. That's for 7th and 8th grade. We don't have anybody for 5th and 6th at this point. Student council, Jim Dolliner?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry.
Yep.
And those are the only ones we have at this point for the middle school.
We have a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendations.
So moved.
Thank you, Trish. Second. Rebecca, any questions? All those in favor of this recommendation? 7-0.
Okay, we have team leaders at the middle school. I should have read these with the other non-student ones, I'm sorry.
That's okay, Lou.
Anne-Marie Dione, World Language. Steve Price, grade 8 team leader. Kristen Cobb, Special Education SAT representative. And then we have some additional ones that are on another memo here. Kathy Walsh, grade 5. Gary Record, grade 6. Aaron Filio, grade 7. Steve Price, grade 8. Those were all for team leaders. Kim Huckel, special education. I already read Anne-Marie Dion. And Andy Strout for allied arts.
Do I have a motion to accept the recommendations of the superintendent?
So moved.
Thank you. A second? Rebecca, any questions? Seeing none, all those in favor? 7-0.
All right. That one we already did,
yep.
Didn't we?
Yes, we did. Are we at the coaching recommendations?
Yes.
Okay. Consideration of the superintendent's recommendations to athletic fee positions for fall 2006.
Okay, from the middle school, we have the following recommendations. We have a new coach that's being recommended, Jody Boyington, for 7th grade field hockey. And it gives you a little bit of background on Jody. And then returning coaches, Diane Nicholson for 8th grade field hockey, Terry Long for 7th grade boys soccer, Jim Dolliner for 8th grade boys soccer, Joe Doan for boys middle school cross country, and Paul Casey for girls middle school cross country.
Thank you. Do we have a motion to accept the middle school athletic nominations?
So moved.
Thank you, Trish. A second?
Second.
Thank you, Ann. Any questions regarding these recommendations? Seeing none, all those in favor? 7-0.
High school?
Yep, we've got the high school.
Okay, we have the following high school athletic nominations. Ben Raymond for varsity boys soccer, Gary Newell for assistant boys soccer, Don Burt for freshman boys soccer, David Weatherby for boys cross country, Mary Ann Doss for girls cross country, Aaron Filio for varsity football, Ron Kierstead for assistant football, Arthur Jones for assistant football, Don Young for assistant football, Tim Wiley for assistant football, and Tom Lawson for assistant football. Laurie Broadhurst for varsity field hockey, Darcy Holland for JV field hockey, and Greg Sandell for golf, and Kevin Harvey, those were all returning coaches, new coach Kevin Harvey for varsity girls soccer. And then I believe I gave you another one as a separate item for girls varsity basketball. It was left on the podium tonight. Mm-hmm. Being recommended is Todd Plummer.
I did see that. Is there a motion to accept the high school athletic recommendation?
So moved.
Thank you, Ann. A second? Linda? Any questions or comments? I just want to say I'm very impressed by the number of coaches that we have returning and also the quality of the hiring process this year and getting a lot of these coaching positions filled prior to the fall. And I appreciate all the hard work that went into that. So all those in favor of this recommendation? 7-0. Yes.
Because Keith Weatherby is still recovering from some aftermath of some of his surgery, I was involved in these hiring things, and I think it's important for the board to understand, but more important for the community to understand that Cape Elizabeth High School has one of the premier soccer programs in the state of Maine, unquestionably. When we had an opening for coaches and advertised that openings, we had one applicant for each of the positions. And that is sort of testimony that I think important information for the public to understand about the difficulty of these jobs, that even a premier school like us, and in part because perhaps we're a premier school, but even other schools that don't have the same community pressures, it's a tough, tough, tough tough job. People are not knocking down the door these days to coach, even though they're inherently fun. But I just thought the board might want to know that, and I wanted to highlight it.
And that's why I kind of wanted to comment, is that I appreciate the hard work in recruiting and the hard work of those coaches that continue to come back for us, and it is appreciated. Thank you for your comment, though. A consideration of a proposal to recognize girls' ice hockey as a sanctioned sport. Kevin, would you like to give some?
Yes. Girls' hockey has been in existence for roughly 6 years. There is a move on through the MPA, Maine Principals Association, to make them a real sport in the high school arena. Our team has requested on several occasions consideration of sanctioning so that they might be prepared to immediately engage once the MPA involves itself in the sport. We met with, I'm sorry, I can't remember his last name, but Peter.
Landis,
yes. At the last Student Activities Committee meeting, and as a result, I move that we sanction girls' ice hockey as a club sport without expense to the school department and in with all applicable other policies in place.
I have a motion.
Sorry.
Ms. Moon.
That wasn't a motion.
Oh, I'm sorry. All right, a second then, thank you.
Second.
All right, Linda. Questions or comments?
I told Peter the price of my support was a copy of the first schedule of games.
Okay. And I do have a question, Kevin.
Yes.
Basically, the sanctioning, very similarly to the other sports that we recently sanctioned as a club sport, basically allows them to compete in some of the main regional competitions that they would like to.
That's the point, that this opens the door for them to compete, with anything that the MPA ultimately sanctions. But also, there is a group of teams that have formed around the concept of pushing the MPA to recognize more sports, specifically girls' sports. Mm-hmm. And I certainly would, on a personal level, endorse equal opportunities for girls in all sports. Our responsibility currently, as we have no funds and we've done with the past teams, is to agree to sanction them for that purpose. They must adhere to our policies that are in place now, but we accept no responsibility for any financial support at this point in time, obviously because there is none available.
Okay. At this point, are there any more questions? Seeing none, all those in favor of this recommendation? 7-0. The additional agenda items. We have a consideration for a school board resolution on the Tabor Initiative that we received from Rebecca.
Elaine? If you wouldn't mind taking number K, I'd like to make a motion.
That's right. I missed the other one. I apologize again. Consideration of proposed non-union central office staff salary and benefits.
I'd like to move that we approve the proposed non-union central office staff salary and benefit changes as discussed in executive session at 6 p.m. this evening.
Second.
Any questions or comments? Seeing none, all those in favor? 7-0. I apologize.
No problem.
back to the additional agenda. Consideration for a school board resolution on the Tabor Initiative. Rebecca.
Okay. First, I want to apologize to the board members for the lateness of this resolution to you. I was waiting on a series of pieces of information in order to get this written. And I actually sent you one in the morning inappropriately, and I sent another one this afternoon in hopes that you would receive it before coming here. And I did, Mary did copy the most recent one for you and left it in front of you as an additional packet item. Should I just go ahead and read it first? How do I do this?
I would suggest that you read it first, and then we open it for a motion.
Okay. I apologize. This is a little lengthy. Whereas the November 7, 2006 ballot will contain a proposed citizens' initiative formally titled An Act to Create the Taxpayers' Bill of Rights, or TABOR, which, if enacted, would limit the growth of state and local revenues or expenditures, which would damage Maine schools and communities. And whereas Colorado, the only state in the nation to enact TABOR, suspended it in November 2005 because the limits on growth were harming education, health care, and threatening its economic well-being. And whereas Colorado's funding under TABOR for local education went from 35th to 49th in the nation as a share of personal income, funding for higher education fell by 31% and now ranks 48th in higher education funding as a share of personal income. And whereas if TABOR had been in effect in fiscal year 2004 in Maine, 172 municipalities, that would be 35% of them, would have negative adjustment factors requiring actual budget cuts. And whereas 101 Maine school administrative units would have had actual budget cuts had TABOR been in effect for fiscal year 2004, while others would have been allowed to grow by over 500%. And whereas TABOR could lead to increased costs and confusion for municipalities by requiring a two-thirds vote by the local governing body and voter approval by referendum, even for minor changes in local mill rate for property taxes or increases in fees merely to cover inflation. And whereas TABOR will limit the legislator's ability to implement real tax reform because any change in the basis for a tax, such as broadening and lowering a tax, or any increase in a tax or fee, however small, will require a two-thirds vote and approval by the voters in the statewide referendum. And whereas TABOR is unconstitutional according to a formal opinion provided to the legislator by the Maine Attorney General on April 5, 2006, the Attorney General finds that a court would likely rule that the two-thirds required vote by the legislator, as well as statewide voter approval for enactment of any measure to increase state revenue, violates several provisions of the Maine Constitution. And whereas the legislator implemented Question 1A and increased aid to local education by more than $250 million for the current biennial budget to support our schools and provide property relief for homeowners, now, therefore, the Cape Elizabeth School Board is taking the step of recommending a specific action on a ballot issue as we urge a no vote on TABOR, since the ballot initiative is apparently unconstitutional as written, sets irrational limits on state and local spending, would impose actual budget cuts in many municipalities, and ignores majority rule by requiring a two-thirds vote at the local and state level for any change in a tax or a fee, and approval by voters in a referendum. Furthermore, we respectfully encourage all voters to carefully read the ballot measure and to consider its consequences in our town and statewide. So I would like to make a motion that the board approve this resolution regarding TABOR.
Second.
Thank you, Kevin. Do we have any comments or questions regarding this resolution? Kathy?
First, I wanted to tell Rebecca that she did a wonderful job shooting this out so quickly. I did have a couple of concerns and maybe a potential amendment. I am concerned that there's a few words in here that are opinion versus fact. I'm specifically referencing the sixth paragraph references confusion for municipalities, and that may be true, but I'm not sure that I'm comfortable with that word being in there. The same thing on the second page, top line, talks about irrational limits. So my recommendation would be that we take out these words and just leave them like as in the on the second page, sets limits on state and local spending. I can appreciate what Rebecca is recommending, and I'm not saying I disagree with your thoughts. I'm just set to stick with the facts and let other people draw their own conclusions, maybe. So, anyway.
I'm trying to think of other words that might not be within the realm of opinion, because I think confusion addresses more coming to terms with all of the various intricacies of this referendum as it would be enacted.
Maybe something like additional work?
Complexities.
Would lead to increased costs and...
That would be good.
Costs and... Okay, complexities. I like that word. And then another one, sets limits. I mean, I think the issue is not necessarily that there's limits, but that they could, how about extreme? No, that's still limits?
I think if you just take out irrational.
Okay.
I mean, I'm the message still carries.
I'm fine with that.
Without okay.
Does it though? I hate to be a nitpicker, but it says sets limits on state and local spending. Some people are going to say that's not a bad thing.
Yeah, and I'm not sure if all of us would necessarily have an issue with that, but it's rather the degree
right.
with which these limits would be put into place.
I'm just not comfortable with the word irrational.
I understand. I'm just, if everyone can bear with us while we try to brainstorm a little bit here.
And that's why I would agree with just taking the word out.
Mm-hmm.
Due to my well-known thought about Paula Pileski and...
I understand.
You know.
Yeah.
Although you know, some people will, some people won't. But we're clearly recommending against this.
Well, there's a very big difference, though, between the Pileski Task Force and a school board resolution.
Yeah.
The board, actually, as a whole, can express opinion about issues. We're not charged with presenting objective analysis of a referendum, but I do understand what you're getting at, and I support trying to change this.
How about restrictive?
Restrictive. Thank you. See, she's our master wordsmith.
Thanks for that consideration.
Yeah. Okay. So with the change, I'm willing to amend my motion to include the changes in the wording. Where Tabor would lead to increased costs and complexities for municipalities, and then the last paragraph sets restrictive limits on state and local spending. Now, I think that's really good, you guys.
With the friendly amendment.
Were you at a council meeting?
Yeah. I like that. I like that. I really do. But with that amendment, we do have a second. We had discussion, so can I have a vote for this to accept this resolution? 7-0.
Great.
Thank you, Rebecca, for the work on that. And Mary, you have a question.
If the motion was amended, doesn't the second? Doesn't that have to be seconded?
Oh.
The amendment.
Mary.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I second the friendly amendment.
That's true.
Or at least the person who seconded it has to agree to second the amended.
Yeah, and I do that too.
Okay.
Between Trish and I, would
I appreciate that input. I have a second on the friendly amendment.
Yeah, it's true.
Kevin.
No, go ahead. Let's raise our hands together.
Thank you. I have a second on the amendment. Now,
take it over.
Are there any other comments on the amendment?
Just a quick comment that I do agree that this was a job well done. The language is appropriate. I wasn't going to spend too much time nitpicking.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I was going to nitpick the language. And it is appropriate because it's clear that what's happened in Colorado shows that this is inimical to quality education as well as other quality services, mm-hmm. which is probably why Colorado has put it on hiatus.
All those in favor of this resolution? Now we're at 7-0. Thank you, Mary. Consideration of the school board's recommendation for Ann Belden and Kevin Sweeney to serve as members on the recently formed Turf Field Committee. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Rebecca. A second? Trish? Any discussion or comments? Kathy?
Yes, I'm concerned that we're not equally dividing up committee work. And I mean no disrespect to fellow board members, but I can't support the recommendation.
Okay. Any other comments?
I would like to add to that that I feel that I have done work in the past as a member of the extracurricular committee, was hoping to continue that work on this special project, which I support 110%. But again, I'm afraid I, too, will not be supporting the motion.
Okay, thank you. I would just like to comment that this was probably the first time that we had more school board members than positions, and I had to make a decision. And I know I disappointed some people who really wanted to be on this committee, but I still would like to make this recommendation. Any other further comments?
I appreciate what Kathy and Linda are saying. From the perspective of listening to what's happened over the past couple of meetings around kids' turf, I'm thinking that it's probably going to be useful to have the chair of extracurricular and the chair of policy be on these, because are we still under a timeline here? I mean, are they still really thinking? No, they're not.
Just to answer your question, and only from one person's perspective, unless something changes dramatically, I don't see how all of this will get through the planning process in order for installation to happen in the fall.
But the expectation perhaps is still there?
The expectation of the citizens group is, but that expectation, both members of the board as well as members of the council, as well as town employees, have tried to draw a more realistic picture of a time frame. We can't control what they, you know. And nobody can knock their enthusiasm.
Well, I just still think it just makes sense to me that the two chairs probably would be best served. So, but again, it would be great if all three could be on. And I understand that the only reason why it's not is because there wouldn't have been a balanced number of representatives on the committee. So,
any other further comments or questions? Seeing none, all those in favor of this recommendation? 5. All those opposed? 2. 5-2. At this point, we have our last public comment.
Excuse me.
Sports Done Right. We have another motion. Consideration for Sports Done Right.
And what I am seeking is the board's approval to pursue further information with the Extracurricular Activities Committee regarding affiliation with the sports, a more formal affiliation with the Sports Done Right program, and to bring that information back the full board and the superintendent for recommendation and further approval purposes. There's fresh money out there with the University of Maine Center for Coaching, and they have put out, and I will have that for you tomorrow. I just barely had time to change tonight, the information on some of the process, and I'd like to follow through on that since this keeps coming up and we never seem to get anything done with it.
Okay. Do I have a motion to...
I think he
has motion, okay. A second to...
A second.
Thank you, Rebecca. Any questions regarding this?
Go for it.
Yeah.
I really want to.
Great. Thank you for the work on that. All those in favor? 7-0. Public comment? Seeing none? School Board agenda requests for our next business meeting.
Have we given any thought as to when that might happen?
Well, we do have a retreat, school board retreat scheduled for Monday, August 21st.
Right. That's not a business meeting.
It is not a business meeting. I do not have that date, whether it's...
No, I was just wondering if we'd even thought about it.
I assume it would be in September unless we felt a need to hold one in early August or the second Tuesday in August. Barring any urgency, I don't see that happening at this point. Dates to remember, as we said, on Friday, June 16th, 11:15 a.m., there is a cookout for all staff. Extracurricular meeting, committee will be meeting on Tuesday, June 20th at 2 p.m. in the Jordan Conference Room. Policy committee will be meeting on Tuesday, June 20th at noontime in the Jordan Conference Room.
Excuse me, Elaine. Updated agenda showing different dates and times.
Yeah, this is the right.
Okay. Extracurricular was correct. Tuesday, June 20th, 2 p.m. Policy committee meeting, June 27th at 8 a.m. in the Jordan Conference Room. Personnel committee, Monday, June 26th at 1 p.m. in the Jordan Conference Room. Finance committee meeting on Tuesday, June 27th, 12:30 p.m. in the superintendent's office. And the school board has scheduled a retreat on Monday, August 21st, 8:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. At Rebecca's home. So at this point, I have a motion. First, I want to thank everybody for a lot of housekeeping and a lot of things to make clear the decks for this summer. But do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Thank you, Kevin. Second. Linda. And all those in favor? 7-0. Thank you and good night.